Welcome. In today's session, we'll be seeing about peptide bond. Okay, how it is formed and what are the characteristics nature of peptide bond, and how to write a peptide bond. Okay. So a peptide bond, a bond which is formed between two amino acids, is said to be a peptide bond. Okay, when two amino acids join together, it results in a bond called peptide bond. The C double bond O NH here is said to be the peptide bond. Okay, so a peptide bond is formed when the carboxyl group of one amino acid reacts with the amino group of another amino acid by losing a water molecule. Okay, so you have to join two amino acids, always write the NH2 terminal end of amino acid in the left hand side. So this is the first amino acid, glycine. Okay, so NH2 group is in the left hand side. Okay, so the same way here also, another glycine, the NH2 group should be written in the left hand side. Okay, so that it's a condensation reaction between two amino acid. So the reaction between two amino acid by eliminating a water molecule result in a bond called peptide bond, C double bond O NH. So the resulting bond is dipeptide. Okay, dipeptide means you should not think that it should have two peptide bonds. Okay, dipeptide means it represents the amino acid is 2, okay, peptide bond is 1. So one peptide bond with 2 amino acid linked with, okay, so 2 amino acid is linked with one peptide bond is said to be a dipeptide. So here the resulting bond is called dipeptide. When you join a third amino acid to this dipeptide through peptide bond, it will result in tripeptide. Similarly, amino acids can further join to form tetrapeptide, pentapeptide, nonapeptide, etc. Okay, so the term peptide is used for a structure which contains more than 50 to 100 amino acids. So you can find peptide bond in a protein. Okay, so this is how a peptide bond is formed, by combining two amino acids. It will result in a bond called peptide bond. So C double bond O NH is the, you have to represent the peptide bond with this C double bond O NH. Okay, so here you can see C double bond O NH group is present, which is linking the two amino acids. So this is how the peptide bond will be formed. Okay, so what are the characteristics of a peptide bond? So the peptide bond is always transplanar. Okay, the transplanar means the peptide bonds have trans configuration, which means that oxygen and hydrogen atoms will be on the opposite sides of the CN bond. So this is the CN bond. When you see the oxygen atom and hydrogen atom, they will remain opposite to each other. Okay, so the peptide bond has a planar structure as a consequence of resonance interactions that give the peptide bond a double bond character. So here you can find a double bond, a partially negative charge and partial positive charge. So a peptide bond has got a double bond character. This peptide bond always assumes a trans conformation. Okay, why the conformation is always trans means, in trans conformation you can see the C alpha atom. Okay, this is the C alpha carbon. The C alpha carbon atoms will be on the opposite side of the peptide bond. So always you can see the successive C alpha atoms. Okay, the successive C alpha atoms will be on the opposite sides of the peptide bond joining them. This means it is in the trans conformation. In cis conformation, the alpha atoms will be on the same side of the peptide bond, which are less stable than that of the trans conformation because of the steric interference between the neighboring side chain. That's the reason why the peptide bond is always trans planar in nature. Okay, it's uncharged and polar character. So how to write this peptide bond structure? Very easy. Okay, it's very simple. You can represent the peptide bond with a zigzag line. Okay, first you draw a zigzag line to represent the main chain or backbone of the protein. Okay, so the main chain or backbone should be represented as a zigzag. You represent and add N C alpha C. Okay, consequently, okay, repeated order, you add N C alpha C, N C alpha C, again N C alpha C. The chain will continue like this only. Always the amino acid will start from N terminal end, N terminal, that amino terminal end and a carboxy terminal end. So always the amino terminal end will be in the left hand side and carboxyl COO group should be in the right hand side. Okay, remember this concept. Write this backbone N C alpha C, N C alpha C. Okay, then now you can add the, okay, now in the repeating order you write N C alpha bond, then in the C alpha, wherever C alpha is present, you write the hydrogen bond. You attach the hydrogen group and the R group. You know the general formula for any amino acid is RCHNH2COOH. Okay, so in the near the C alpha, you write the H hydrogen atom and the R group. Then in the nitrogen also, okay, in the C alpha, you are going to attach the hydrogen C alpha and N. Wherever N and C alpha is present, just add the hydrogen atom. Okay, in the C alpha alone, you attach the R group. Then in the carbonyl, in the final, you are actually, you have to add the oxygen to the carbonyl group. So this blue color represent the carbonyl group where you are going to attach the double bond O. Okay, so oxygen should be attached in the carbonyl group. In the C alpha, in the green color, I have represented C alpha carbon. So in the C alpha carbon, you attach a hydrogen atom and a R group. And wherever N is present, in between wherever N is present, you attach a hydrogen atom. In the final terminal ends, you add NH2 group or NH3 plus group and COO minus group. Okay, in the terminal ends alone, you can add NH2 or CO, C, in this carbonyl terminal, you can add COO minus. So this is how you have to write the peptide bond structure. Very simple to write the peptide bond structure. Okay, then planar rotation of the peptide bond. So what is meant by this torsion angle and how this peptide bond is having rotation? Okay, so in the fully extended polypeptide chain, the atoms of the peptide bond, okay, that is the C double bond O NH. Okay, this here it is C double bond O NH group. These are the they are coplanar. Always you can see that they are these bonds. C double bond O NH is the peptide bond. These peptide bonds will be in a coplanar in nature. Okay, I'll represent like this. Okay, see the backbone N C alpha C, N C alpha C. Okay, so the peptide bonds, the yellow colored regions are the represents the peptide bond. Okay, all lies in the coplanar structure. The unshaded atoms, okay, where the atoms C alpha and RH are unshaded atoms, okay, represents the C alpha carbon, hydrogen atom and the R group. Free rotation, how the peptide bond rotation occurs means, the free rotation occurs only at bonds that connect the alpha carbon with N. Okay, C alpha, anything which is linked with this C alpha carbon alone can have the power to rotate. Okay, so this here, yeah, C alpha and N can have the rotation. Again C alpha and C group can have the rotation. So the angle of rotation is represented by this C alpha C bond is represented by psi angle. Okay, PSI, psi bond, this is called the psi angle. And C alpha N represents the phi bond or phi angle. Okay, whereas this this bond, this group is there, no, N and C. Here this N, that is CN, okay, this CN will not have any rotating power. CN, okay, in the peptide bond you have got one carbonyl and a nitrogen group. Okay, this will not have the power to rotate. So this peptide bond position, where the peptide bond is present, there is no degree of rotation will be there. Whereas this C alpha N and C alpha C have the power to have rotation. Okay. Thus, there is no freedom of rotation about the bond that connects the carbon and nitrogen of the peptide bond. C N bond have no freedom of rotation. You have to remember this. Okay. So that is what shown here. So the free angle of rotation, which is represented by C alpha, this is alpha carbon, C alpha and N is the psi bond, okay, represented by the symbol psi, and C alpha and C, okay, here the represented C alpha and N is the phi bond, okay, C alpha and N is the phi bond, and C alpha C is the psi bond. They have the angle of rotation, whereas the CC bond, that is the peptide CN bond, will not have any degree of rotation. Okay. So the torsion angles between the peptide bond describes the, what is the need for this, means they will describe the polypeptide chain conformations. The backbone or the main chain in a protein refers to the atoms that participates in the peptide bonds. The conformation of the backbone, which has the ability to rotate, as that is the phi and the psi bond, okay. These angles phi and psi bonds are defined to be 180 degree. It will have the angle of degree from minus 180 to plus 180 degree, which are represented in the Ramachandra plot, okay. So the rotation around this C alpha N and C alpha C bonds may cause the amide H group and carbonyl C double bond O group or the other substituents of C alpha residues to collide. So this Ramachandra plot, okay, here I'll show the Ramachandra plot indicates that the allowed conformations in the polypeptide chain. So according to the degree of rotation, minus 182, it can have the values from minus 180 to plus 180, either phi degree or psi degree, okay. So this peptide bonds will restrict secondary conformations. Free rotation is possible only two of the three covalent bonds, that is C alpha C bond and the C alpha N bond. The partial double bond character of the peptide bond that links the C to N, okay, in the peptide bond you have a C group and a N group, C double bond O NH. In that C and N prevent the rotation, okay, it will not have any degree of rotation. The angle C alpha N is termed as we know that the angle C alpha N is termed as the phi angle, and C alpha bond is the psi angle, okay. For amino acid other than glycine, okay, for amino acid other than glycine, most combinations of phi and psi angles are disallowed because of the steric hindrance. Since glycine is very small, no, so they will, okay, they are not disallowed because of the steric hindrance in the Ramachandra plant. They will not be seen in the secondary structures. The conformation of proline are even more restricted. So you cannot find the group like the amino acids like glycine and proline in any one of the structures in the secondary conformation due to steric hindrance. Okay, because proline is also due to the absence of the free rotation. The regions of secondary structures arise. Okay, so whatever secondary structure which falls on this Ramachandra plot, it is divided into four quadrant. So in the left hand side quadrant, up and down, okay, this is the bottom and this is the top. So in the left hand side, whatever in the left hand side quadrant, that lower and upper left hand quadrants will have right handed alpha helical structure, okay, whatever amino acids secondary structure which arise due to a series of amino acid residues will fall within this phi and psi angle. Hence the common secondary structures includes alpha helix, beta pleated sheets, okay, and right handed alpha helix mainly, then parallel, anti-parallel and parallel beta slits, collagen triple helix. All these will fall in this category, left and lower and upper left handed quadrants in the Ramachandra plant, whereas this right side, whichever secondary conformations are probably, which is left handed helix, which is not a natural one. Okay, so this is how the peptide bonds will restrict secondary conformations. Then we'll know about some of the important biologically important peptides. So dipeptide, so we all know that when two amino acids are linked together by one peptide bond, it is called to be a dipeptide. So example for this dipeptide is aspartame. It consists of one amino acid aspartame linked with phenylalanine. Okay, so these two amino acid aspartate and phenylalanine are linked, it will result in the formation of dipeptide. It's present in the African berry. It acts as a sweetening agent. Then tripeptide, so it means that tri means here it represents three amino acids linked together by two peptide bonds. Okay, example for this is glutathione is a very good example for this tripeptide. It consists of three amino acids, glutamate, cysteine and glycine. It is present in the erythrocytes and other tissues. The main function of it is it acts as a reducing agent. It has got so many functions. It is responsible for the maintenance of SH groups of proteins in the reduced form. Octa, the term octa means 8. Okay, 8 amino acids. Angiotensin 2. So it is an octapeptide found in the lungs and other cells. It is a powerful vasoconstrictor and raises the blood pressure. Nonapeptides, so 9 amino acids are linked together. Examples includes bradykinin. It consists of 9 amino acids. It's a powerful vasodilator. Oxytocin is also a nonapeptide. It stimulates uterus contraction. And vasopressin is also an example for nonapeptide produced by the pituitary gland. It is also known as antidiuretic hormone. Then decapeptide, 10 amino acids, angiotensin 1 and calidin are examples for decapeptides containing 10 amino acid residues. Cyclic peptides, gramicidin S, an antibiotic. Okay, this gramicidin S is an antibiotic which has got cyclic structure. It consists of 10 amino acids. Toxic peptides, there are some toxic peptides also present. The alpha amantin is a bicyclic octapeptide. It is present particularly in a variety of mushrooms. It is extremely toxic to humans. When these mushrooms are consumed, it causes pain in the gastrointestinal tract, vomiting, diarrhea, nausea. Death also occurs within a week due to impairment of liver and kidney function. Okay, so these are about the biological importance of peptides. Hope you all have understood the mechanism of peptide bond formation, what are the characteristics of a peptide bond, and you also learned some biologically important peptides. Thank you for watching this video. Subscribe and support the channel Biochemistry DSP.